Welcome to the Knowledgeably Yours podcast. I'm Kaustubh, and in today's episode, we are going to discuss a disease that is affecting hundreds of millions of people around the world, type 2 diabetes. Now, you might be someone who looks at themselves in the mirror and thinks, I am fit. This disease is unlikely to happen to me. You might be someone who has recently gotten the news that you are type 2 diabetic. Or you might be someone who has battled for ages with this disease, or you yourself may not have this disease, but care for someone who has it. No matter who you are, I strongly believe that the contents of this podcast will be of immense use to you. So please stay tuned. This is likely going to be a very long podcast, but I assure you that the information being shared is extremely valuable and useful. So stay tuned. Before we get started, it is important for me to put out a medical disclaimer. The contents of this podcast should not be considered as medical advice under any circumstances. And there are two reasons for this. Firstly, I am not a healthcare professional. I am not a medically trained doctor. My primary education has been in physics and astrophysics, and I am currently working in the domain of artificial intelligence and data science. So it's a very different domain of work. But I have personally suffered of this disease, and I have seen people very close to me suffer of this disease. And as a result of this, I have done a lot of research, and I wish to use this podcast to share all my knowledge and information that I have gathered in the last couple of years about this disease with all of you. And even if I was a healthcare professional, I would still put out this disclaimer that the contents of the podcast should not be considered as medical advice. And the reason for this is that each one of us is unique, with different bodies, different weaknesses, different strengths, different genetics. And there is no such thing as a generic medical advice. For example, you might be someone who is suffering of calcium deficiency, and you might read somewhere that drinking milk is great because it is a fantastic source of calcium. But what if you're lactose intolerant? Isn't drinking milk one of the worst advices that you could give to a patient? Medical workers, healthcare professionals, go through years of hard work and training so that they are able to tailor the treatment according to the person. So, under any circumstances, based on the contents of this podcast, you should not change your diet or your medications, and especially those of you who are taking insulin injection shots should never change your dosages without advice. The correct way to use the information being given out in this podcast is to go to your doctor and discuss it with them. Say that you would like to try out a couple of things. And if your doctor refuses or does not even wish to have a discussion, it is always possible to seek out a new doctor. I personally like to have a doctor who encourages questions, who is willing to give as much information as I seek from him or her, and guide me throughout. So this is how you must use the contents of this podcast. And with that disclaimer out of the way, we can begin. So let us start by asking the question, what exactly is diabetes? You have to appreciate that diabetes as a disease is discussed as if it is modern, but historically it has been known. Diabetes means frequent urination. And even a couple of millennia ago, there are records of people having this disease. So diabetes is characterized by frequent urination. And as a result of this frequent urination, people, of course, feel very thirsty. Now let's try to imagine a weird scenario. Imagine there is a yard and a person who is known to have this problem of frequent urination, that is diabetes, urinates in one part of the yard. Now there is another person who is considered not diabetic, more or less normal. He also urinates in the yard but in a different place. What physicians noticed is that when a person suffering of diabetes, this disease of frequent urination, urinates, ants are attracted to that urine. Now, until recently, we did not have the technology to do pathological tests on urine and blood. So physicians who wanted to find out what was special about this urine, literally had to take that sample of urine and taste it. And when they tasted the urine, they found that it was sweet. And hence, in ancient Indian medical literature, the disease of diabetes is also known as madhumeha, which means honey-like urine. Today, of course, diabetes is not diagnosed by tasting urine. We have pathological tests to do that. One common test that is done to establish that a person has diabetes is that their sample of urine is collected. If the sample of urine contains glucose, as judged through various chemical reactions, the person likely has diabetes. The classical blood test that was done to establish that a patient is diabetic was that you would have your dinner in the evening, 12 hours later, the next day morning when you have woken up. Without eating anything, you would go to the pathology lab and give a sample of blood. If the level of sugar in your blood happened to be greater than 120 milligrams per deciliter, then you were considered diabetic. As a backup test, you were asked to have your meal and come back exactly 2 hours later to give another sample of blood. And if the concentration of sugar in your blood was greater than 200 milligrams per deciliter, then again you were considered diabetic. But this classical blood test of establishing whether a patient is diabetic or not has a major disadvantage. Imagine that you wake up in the morning and you decide that since the pathology lab is nearby, you're going to walk towards the lab. So you decide to walk on an empty stomach to your pathology lab. The lab is in a building, and in particular, it is, let's say, on the 8th or the 9th floor of the building. So you decide to climb the stairs instead of taking the elevator. Now, because of all the physical activity you have done, your blood sugar will fall down. And as a result, it might come out to be normal even though you're diabetic. So the problem is that this exact concentration of sugar at that particular point of time can be very biased. So a more reliable test that is conducted is what is called as the HbA1c test. So because there is glucose in your blood, the glucose and the hemoglobin molecule react in order to form a molecule known as glycated hemoglobin, which is what is chemically written down as HbA1c. Now, imagine that you have had consistently high sugars for a period of approximately 3 months. Then the percentage of such molecules in your bloodstream will be very high. On the other hand, if you have had consistently low sugar, then the percentage of such molecules will be low. And this test does not depend upon whether you just walked into the lab, climbed a few bunch of staircases to reach the lab. It does not depend on that. Some people like to call it the 3 monthly average sugar, something that is far more reliable than your instantaneous sugar level. The pathology result for HbA1c typically comes in the form of a percentage. If it is less than 5.7, you are considered normal. If it is greater than 7.5, you are considered diabetic. And if it is something in between, you are categorized as pre-diabetic, which means someone who is likely on the way to having full-blown diabetes. Now, what you have to appreciate is that the above tests and the related symptoms will be positive for completely different reasons. And it was not until the 1960s that it was realized that diabetes actually comes in two varieties, at least two varieties, and they are completely different. So let's start with what is called as type 1 diabetes or diabetes insipidus. So patients who have type 1 diabetes suffer from a condition known as autoimmune disorder. An autoimmune disorder is wherein the immune system of the body, whose purpose is to fight against external infections, accidentally starts targeting healthy cells within the body. So in a type 1 diabetic, as a result of the autoimmune disorder, the immune system ends up destroying the beta cells in the pancreas, which are responsible for the production of a hormone known as insulin. We will study insulin in great detail as we move along, but a major purpose of the insulin is that it helps the organs of the body absorb glucose. But since there is no insulin, the organs of the body do not absorb any glucose. As a result, the level of blood glucose remains very high. And when the kidneys detect that there are very toxic levels of glucose in the blood, remember that kidney is essentially a filtration organ. It is responsible for taking what it considers toxic and discharges it as urine. So the kidneys detect the high level of blood glucose and they start discharging glucose through urine, and this happens frequently, and that explains the symptoms of why diabetic patients urinate frequently and why their urine also contains glucose and hence the urine is actually sweet. So this is type 1 diabetes. But there is also type 2 diabetes, which is the major topic for today. It is known as diabetes mellitus. In type 2 diabetes, the symptoms are largely the same, but the causes are entirely different. In type 2 diabetics, the beta cells are very much present in the pancreas. Insulin is also being produced by these beta cells. What happens in type 2 diabetics is that the insulin tells the organs of your body, the cells of your body, to absorb glucose. But the cells are like bad students who refuse to listen to their teachers. The insulin tells the cells to absorb glucose and the cells say, sorry, we will not absorb the glucose. This is called as insulin resistance. And the same story occurs. Because the cells are not listening to insulin, the blood glucose remains high. The kidneys detect these toxic levels of glucose and start discharging or getting rid of glucose via urination, and you see that the same symptoms are manifested. Historically, people have discovered that there are some treatments that are curing diabetics. But while they were making some diabetics better, they were actually killing other diabetics. And the reason is because there are two different kinds of diabetes, and because the underlying causes of these two diabetic conditions are different, they require different treatments. Especially when you ask people who are benefiting from some treatment and are type 2 diabetic, if you give the same treatment to type 1 diabetics, they'll likely die, right? And we have to understand the underlying causes properly and therefore the resultant treatments. In case of type 1 diabetics, as we said, the immune system has destroyed the beta cells. There is no insulin production happening. And therefore, in case of type 1 diabetics, there is no choice but to supply the insulin externally. It was in 1921 that Banting was able to extract insulin from a cow and process it so that it was safe to inject into human beings. And when insulin injections were administered to type 1 diabetics, they improved their health considerably. Type 1 diabetics were known not to live for more than, say, 10-20 years, but they started living far more after insulin injections were administered to them. As a result, Banting actually won the Nobel Prize for his discovery and extraction of insulin. But what is the treatment for type 2? If type 1 diabetics require compulsory insulin supplements, what is the treatment for type 2 diabetes? This is a question that I intend to answer as we go along, as best as I can and as best as I understand. But let's try to first understand what the common scenario a type 2 diabetic patient typically faces. So imagine there is a patient who has just been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. They have gone to the pathology lab, they have given their urine test, they have given their blood test, and the tests have come back with all indicators and markers of type 2 diabetes. So what is the typical conversation that happens between a patient and a doctor? The doctor first gives the bad news to the patient and says, you have to change your lifestyle. I'm sorry, you have type 2 diabetes. The first thing that we will do is that we will start you on medications. The two most common medications that are given are glimepiride, which is a class of drugs known as sulfonylureas, and metformin. And the purpose of these drugs, as the doctor explains, is that it will help you regulate the level of glucose or sugar in your blood, which is important. Next, the doctor advises you that you must also change your diet. You should not put the sugar that you put in your coffee or tea when you have it in the morning. You should avoid sweets. And when you have food, you must have controlled portions of food. Not eat as much as you want. There'll be a restricted amount of food that you will eat. And a very common advice that I have heard many doctors give to type 2 diabetic patients is that they must eat small portions many times a day. And the explanation typically given is that you have to maintain the levels of sugar in your blood. The medications that you are taking can severely decrease the level of sugar in your blood. This is a condition known as hypoglycemia. When a patient suffers of hypoglycemia, they can faint, they feel extremely nauseated sometimes, and under severe hypoglycemic conditions, even the brain can potentially get damaged. Doctors, in fact, say it's better to have slightly higher sugar than normal, but please don't suffer of lower than normal levels of sugar in your blood. After all these explanations have been given by the doctor, a common question that a type 2 diabetic patient asks is, how long do I have to take the medications? How long will all this quote-unquote treatment go on? And the sad answer that is given is forever. It is commonly believed and commonly advised by many doctors that type 2 diabetics are going to be type 2 diabetics forever. And the common story of many diabetics that I have personally witnessed is that after diagnosis, they go through a period of adjustment where they change their lifestyle, they change their diet, they start walking more regularly, they start taking medications regularly. And eventually, in a couple of weeks, when they go to the pathology lab again, they find that the levels of sugar in their blood have been stabilized. In many patients, the further story is that as years and years keep passing by, the medicines are no longer enough to maintain the levels of glucose in the blood. And finally, they are given insulin injections, right? And they are typically told that, you know, your body is no longer able to produce insulin naturally, so we have to give injections externally. Otherwise, we cannot maintain your blood sugars within a normal level. And indeed, by judging by these stories of many diabetic patients, it seems like the doctor's warning or, you know, the diagnosis was correct, that type 2 diabetes is a disease that indeed lasts forever. It is a chronic condition. But type 2 diabetes is not just about sugar levels. It is a whole body disease. If you have type 2 diabetes, it's not just that, oh, the sugar is high, let's bring it down. Type 2 diabetes affects the patient in almost every body part. Common well-known problems that type 2 diabetics have to suffer include the following. Retinopathy. So there are these small blood vessels that are supplying blood to the retina, which is a critical component of your eye and is responsible for vision. When the blood supply to the retina gets affected, and this happens as a result of type 2 diabetes, it can lead to complete blindness. Another problem is nephropathy, which means that your kidneys also start losing their functions, eventually failing completely. I know examples of patients who had to be on dialysis forever, where you're hooked to a machine and that artificially makes your kidneys do what they are actually supposed to do naturally. Neuropathy is another problem among type 2 diabetes. Neuropathy essentially affects the nerve endings, and people experience numbness in their feet and their hands. They experience a certain burning sensation. One extreme case that I know, this person had very uncontrolled diabetes for a very long time and had lost all sensation in his foot. And one day he gets an injury on his foot and doesn't even know that he's got the injury. So numb his feet have that they don't experience any pain. So he's got this injury. He's not attending to it because he doesn't even know it's there, and it starts festering, catching severe infection. Atherosclerosis is another problem that type 2 diabetics suffer. Here, the large arteries and veins in the blood circulation system, the blood circulation gets affected in these veins and arteries, and that can lead to tissue damage and severe pain in the legs. Type 2 diabetics are at immense risk for heart diseases as well as strokes. A stroke is a condition where blood supply to the brain is hindered, and that can even render a person paralytic. I know someone who actually had a stroke and half their body was paralytic until they died. Another common symptom is peripheral vascular disease, where the legs do not get an adequate supply of blood, and whenever there is a tissue that gets damaged, it doesn't heal and it becomes highly infectious. We call it gangrene. And the only choice that remains is to amputate that part of the body which has caught that infection. It's one of the worst things that could possibly happen to someone. And in the last few decades, diabetes type 2 has also been correlated with the following: Alzheimer's disease, cancer, fatty liver, low immunity. Now, low immunity is something that is personal for me, right? A couple of years ago, I was falling ill very frequently. The first time I fell ill, my doctor advised me to take a very strong course of antibiotics, which lasted for 5 days. That's a very severe course. And I took the course of antibiotics, I was all right. And then few weeks later, I fell ill once again. And the doctor did not want to give me antibiotics because I had just taken a course. But seeing that my body was not responding and I was becoming weaker and weaker, I was reluctantly given another course of antibiotics by my doctor. Then another couple of weeks later, I caught another fever. And this time it was very bad. My joints started to ache and I was in a pathetic condition. Once again, the doctor had to reluctantly prescribe antibiotics. And finally, I went to a completely different doctor. I was traveling during that time and I was visiting different doctors for all these three problems. But I went back to my actual physician in my city. and I asked for their advice. I said, why am I falling ill so frequently? And they immediately suspected something. They asked me to undergo a series of tests. As I realized later, all these tests were to check whether I had type 2 diabetes and whether my vitamin levels were deficient. And indeed, that is when my type 2 diabetes was actually diagnosed. My fasting sugar, my HbA1c, my post-meal sugar, my urine sugar, everything came out to be sky high. And that is how the news that I had type 2 diabetes was disclosed to me, because of low immunity, right? My immunity was severely compromised. Among females, the condition known as polycystic ovarian syndrome is also correlated with type 2 diabetes. So one of the questions we have to ask is, I told you earlier that when a type 2 diabetic patient asks for treatment, the doctor gives them a series of medications, right? These medicines control sugar. The question now that we have to ask ourselves is, imagine that there is a patient who is very disciplined, takes the medications on time, eats exactly the kind of food that the doctor has asked him to eat, and you know, they are exercising, they are walking in the morning just as the doctor advised, and they are on medications for 10 years, 15 years, and if you see every single report that this person produces, perfect, absolute normal levels of everything. The question I want to ask is, does such a person avoid suffering from all the problems that I said typically affect type 2 diabetics? You might be shocked, or maybe not, to hear this, but most of the times, even after controlling their sugar levels for years and years, for decades, with discipline, type 2 diabetic patients are not able to avoid many of the problems that I just listed. And the reason is that all the medicines and the treatment that type 2 diabetic patients are taking is for controlling the levels of sugar. But is high sugar the complete story of type 2 diabetes? The remaining podcast will try to answer this question. We will go in depth, understand the biochemistry of diabetes type 2, and it is in the understanding of the biochemistry of type 2 diabetes that we will be able to find an explanation for how to treat type 2 diabetes, and we will be able to compare whether our reasoning, based on our in-depth understanding of type 2 diabetes, agrees with the conventional wisdom on type 2 diabetes that many people believe in. So let's get started. Before we move into what happens inside the body, let's conduct a very cruel experiment to drive a point home, right? So it's a very cruel experiment, as you'll understand why. Imagine that there is a contest. The contest says that when you enroll in the contest, you must submit the names of 100 people around you. Once you submit the names of these 100 people, in 5 years, we will carry out tests on these people, and we will check whether they have type 2 diabetes or not. The person who is able to select 100 people such that maximum people will get type 2 diabetes in 5 years will win a prize. I'm sure you understand why I'm calling it a very cruel experiment. So the question is, if you want to win this contest, how will you select the 100 people? And the answer is, you would choose the most obese people. So that means now we have to define what obesity is, right? So in to define obesity, we measure the height of a person, we measure the weight of a person in suitable units, and we divide the weight by the square of the height. This is known as BMI, body mass index. If the body mass index is greater than 25, you're considered obese. If it's greater than 30, severely obese. Greater than 35, morbidly obese. Very, very high form of obesity. In fact, if you cross BMI of 40, you might even be advised to go for surgical removal of your fat. It is the most extreme BMI that we come across in today's day and age. So, once again, if you were to select 100 people who had the best chance of getting type 2 diabetes in the next 5 years, you would choose the people with the highest BMI, aka you would choose the most obese people. Now, when you hear this and you know that your weight is very close to normal, you start celebrating, right? I am not going to get type 2 diabetes because, you know, people who are obese tend to get diabetes. Yes, that is what the statistics say. The more obese you are, the greater is the chance that you will get type 2 diabetes. But, I want to drive another important point home. For that, we'll play another cruel game. Let us choose. So the rules of the contest will change now. Now you have to choose 100 people. The restriction is that all those 100 people must be between 23 to 26 BMI. Now you have to choose 100 people who have the highest chance of getting type 2 diabetes in the next 5 years. And the people who design this contest know that since I have taken away most of the obese people away from you, I must give you some other information. So let's imagine that the body scans of the people are available. So in order to choose your 100 people among 23 to 26 BMI, you will be able to look at the scans as an input information to decide. So how would you do it? How would you select the people with the highest risk for type 2 diabetes? To explain the winning strategy, we'll have to understand that fats in the body come in two flavors, if I may be liberal with that term. One kind of fat is what we call subcutaneous. This is the fat that is deposited underneath your skin. So if you see a fat person who has very fat arms, very fat legs and cheeks, they likely have very high deposits of subcutaneous fat. Fats deposited under the skin, which is what makes those body parts appear very fluffed up or very fat. Generally, these subcutaneous fats are not severely harmful, but there is another flavor of fat which is extremely harmful. This is known as visceral fat. This is the fat largely concentrated in your abdomen and embedded in your organs. There's a technical term called ectopic fat to describe the fat that is embedded inside your organs, right? And the winning strategy for this new contest is that you must choose the people who have highest amount of visceral fat. So even though your BMI can be normal, if you have a very high amount of visceral fat, fat concentrations in your abdomen, inside the organs placed near the abdomen, then you will have a very high risk of type 2 diabetes. So if you ever wondered how is it possible for a person with reasonable BMI to get type 2 diabetes while a person with high BMI not getting type 2 diabetes, it is not just that you need a person to be fat, you need that fat to be largely visceral in nature. If a person's BMI is high because of mostly subcutaneous fat, it is not so harmful. But if a person is not fat but has a lot of visceral fat, they are at a very high risk. So the whole purpose of this exercise was to point out that yes, there is a correlation between obesity and diabetes. The more obese you are, the greater the chance there is for diabetes. It was also to bring the point home as a warning to people who look at themselves in the mirror and feel, I am thin. The point of this exercise was to remind such people that it is not purely the BMI that determines the type 2 diabetes outcome. It is the exact location of your fat. So this is a sort of a statistical observation, right? This is a statistical observation. But why is this true? Why is this relationship there? Why does such a correlation exist? We will soon understand this. And in order to understand it, we will have to take a deep dive into the biochemistry of type 2 diabetes. And our first stop in our journey to understand this is to understand what is the role of insulin in digestion. All right, let's begin. We all eat food. Food is composed of two kinds of nutrients. We have micronutrients and we have macronutrients. Micronutrients, as the name implies, are microscopic in amounts. These are your vitamins, your minerals. These are very, very small in amount and get directly absorbed by your body. So we will leave aside micronutrients. For our diabetes type 2 story, we are interested in macronutrients. There are three varieties of macronutrients which almost every person on earth who has some level of education has heard about them. These are carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. The carbohydrates are broken through the process of digestion into glucose and other sugars for letting the body absorb them. The proteins are broken into amino acids and the fats are broken into fatty acids. So the digestive system breaks the carbs into glucose and other sugars, proteins into amino acids and fats into fatty acids. Now let's talk about carbs and proteins. When you eat carbs and proteins, the level of insulin in your body spikes. That is, it increases in amount. So there's a very complex signal processing that happens in your body. As soon as you eat food, the food contains carbohydrates and proteins. All kinds of signaling takes place in the body and the pancreas manufacture insulin. So the level of insulin in your blood increases when you eat carbohydrates and proteins. This insulin level by increasing is now preparing the liver and sort of giving a warning to the liver. Hey liver, this gentleman has just, or this lady has just eaten glucose and amino acids in the form of carbs and proteins. Please get ready, right? One of the functions of insulin is to enable absorption of glucose. So try to think of each cell in the body as a room, right? That room is locked. We need glucose to go inside the cell so that cell can do its job properly. The glucose is the source of energy for the cell to do its job. But the door of the cell is locked. So how does the glucose enter in? So you can think of insulin as a key that opens the lock so that glucose can enter the cell. That's a simple way to think about one primary function of insulin, right? So what happens is that when you eat carbohydrates, it gets broken down into glucose. Through the action of insulin, the cells are able to absorb the glucose, but the cells have a certain finite capacity to absorb the glucose. Any excess glucose will be stored by the body. A similar story happens in the case of proteins. So proteins are broken into amino acids. Amino acids are required by the body for tissue building and repair, and any excess amino acids are again broken down into glucose and stored. You would be interested to know that the fatty acids, on the other hand, are not digested or processed by the liver. They are directly absorbed by a system known as the lymphatic system. And the liver is not involved in the processing of fatty acids or the absorption of fatty acids, which is why when you eat foods that are primarily fatty in nature, don't have any carbohydrates or proteins, they actually don't change the level of blood insulin significantly, because, you know, insulin does not play a role in the absorption of fatty acids. That's a different system altogether. But back to the point of carbohydrates and proteins, as I said, carbs become glucose, glucose gets absorbed by organs, any excess glucose will be stored by the body. A similar story with proteins, broken into amino acids, used for tissue building and repair, any excess amino acids synthesized into glucose, and the excess is stored. The question we have to ask is, how is this excess glucose stored by the body? The primary mechanism by which glucose is stored in your body is by chaining glucose molecules together and forming a substance known as glycogen. Liver has a certain capacity in it to store glycogen. Even the tissues, your hand muscles, your leg muscles, have a capacity to store glycogen in it. This is like a reserve storage of energy. Imagine that you are walking on the street and a thug comes and stands in front of you and threatens you. You might decide to run away. That means all of a sudden your legs require tremendous amount of energy. It is this glycogen storage in your leg muscles that will serve as the first source of energy, right? Or you might decide you can take care of the thug and you start boxing with the thug, and all of a sudden your arms need a lot of energy. So again, that glycogen store will be utilized. So whatever glycogen is stored in your arms or other tissues can be utilized only by that particular tissue. But the glycogen that is stored in the liver can be utilized by the whole body. Anyway, what is important is that whether it is the glycogen that is stored in the liver or the glycogen that is stored in individual tissues, there is a limited capacity. There is a limited glycogen capacity. You cannot store more glycogen than the capacity of the liver or those tissues. But imagine that you have eaten so much that your organs have happily absorbed the glucose, right? The glucose has been converted to glycogen, and even the storage area of your body for keeping glycogen is also full. What happens then? Now, this can come as a shock for some people. The remaining glucose is converted into triglycerides. Any remaining excess glucose is converted into triglycerides, which are nothing but fat molecules. These triglycerides are transported to the fat cells, technically known as adipose tissues or adipocytes, and the triglycerides are stored there. This is what you call body fat. There's a nice name given to this process. I love this name. It's DNL, de novo lipogenesis. Easy to understand if you dissect the words. De novo means new, lipo means fat, genesis means creation. So creating new fats from glucose is called de novo lipogenesis, DNL. And insulin also plays an important role in this process. When the level of glucose in the blood remains high, de novo lipogenesis is initiated with the help of insulin by the liver to convert glucose into triglycerides, which will get deposited into your fat cells, and that is how you become fat. Now, I have been a more than normal weighted person in my life, most of my life. And every time I used to get free advice from everyone, right? So, and the biggest advice I get is don't eat cheese, don't drink milk, don't eat oil, don't eat ghee, that is clarified butter. All of these are fats. So they were essentially taking what are called dietary fats. And they had this one-to-one correlation, right? Dietary fat becomes body fat. The more dietary fat you eat, the more body fat you will accumulate. But when I read this for the first time, I realized why I could become fat, even though in my family, we hardly ate any dietary fat. Compared to many families, especially in the subcontinent of India, the amount of dietary fat my family was consuming was ridiculously low, and yet here we were becoming fat. And this was the explanation I needed. When you eat enough carbohydrates, so much so that they are broken down to such a large amount of glucose, that not only do organs have enough glucose, not only does liver manufacture glycogen and has sufficient amount of it, there is still glucose left. And the insulin is taking that glucose and converting it into triglycerides. And that dispelled that myth for me, that dietary fat doesn't make you body fat. It is excess carbohydrates that makes you body fat. So we learned a good lesson from just a little bit of biochemistry here, right? So this is what happens when you eat. So what happens when you stop eating? The reverse processes happen. The organs have some glucose. They will utilize it for their energy. When that glucose is over, various processes start in the body and the glycogen stores are now utilized. And if the glycogen stores are also exhausted, then the body will perform a new process. This is called gluconeogenesis. Again, easy to understand. Gluco means glucose. Neo means new. Genesis, creation. Where does new sugar come from? Organs have lost their glucose. Glycogen is also over. But now I am saying that when both these things are over, gluconeogenesis, construction of new glucose, is happening. From where? Through a completely different process which breaks the triglyceride molecules back into glucose. The reverse of de novo lipogenesis. So having understood this simple process, simple forward process and reverse process, we can answer the question, how to become fat? Easy. Eat sufficient amount of carbohydrates. Let these carbohydrates raise the level of insulin in your body. Let there be so much glucose because of having eaten so much carbohydrates that let organs will have enough glucose. Glycogen reserves will become full and the body will have no choice but to keep producing more insulin to help convert the remaining glucose into triglycerides. Moreover, don't let the reverse process happen, which means don't reach a point where your glycogen will also be exhausted, so that fat burning will never take place. Keep on at it and you will become fat. So, in short, keep eating continuously a high carbohydrate rich diet and you will be on your way to become fat. It's as easy as that. And more importantly, not all carbohydrates will help you with this. It is a specific types of carbohydrates that will make you fat. As I said, the process of fat manufacturing happens when the insulin levels are extremely high. So there are some carbohydrates which are especially good at boosting the levels of insulin and also get converted into glucose very, very easily. These are the carbohydrates that you should eat to become fat, or a better advice is please avoid these carbohydrates if you don't want to become fat. So if I had to define these carbs in three words, they would be highly refined carbohydrates. And now get ready for immense bad news. What are these highly refined carbohydrates? Cakes, pastries, biscuits, pastas, cornflakes, white rice, all kinds of breads, potatoes, sweets. All of these are highly refined carbohydrates. Okay? Now, remember that we have not yet understood how type 2 diabetes happens. We've only understood what insulin does and what role do carbs play in making insulin do what it does, which is help in absorption of sugar, create glycogen, create triglycerides. But now that we've understood this, we can better answer the question, when does type 2 diabetes come into the picture? So you just need to take one extra step. Imagine that you have eaten these high amounts of carbohydrates and your body has produced this very high amount of insulin. As I mentioned to you, insulin is responsible for signaling your cells to absorb glucose. And when we were talking about the difference between type 1 and type 2, I said what happens in type 2 diabetes is that the cells do not pay any attention to insulin. This is called as insulin resistance. So when the insulin resistance in your body increases, when there is a very high level of insulin in your body, cells start resisting the action of insulin and your levels of glucose in the blood continue to remain very high. Because of this extremely high amount of glucose in your blood, even more insulin is produced by the body. This insulin drives the production of fat, and because of what is called as glucotoxicity, that is extremely toxic levels of sugar in your blood, the kidneys also start throwing away sugar through urination, right? So that is what type 2 diabetes is. In this entire chain of digestion, if we reach such a high level of insulin that the cells start resisting the action of insulin, you become type 2 diabetic. But wait, why does insulin resistance happen? Why does insulin resistance happen? It's clear that when insulin resistance happens, you have this runaway effect of incredible amounts of insulin being produced to maintain the level of glucose in the blood. That seems clear enough, but why would the cells resist insulin? So let's see. You have to appreciate that any kind of resistance in the body is a natural phenomena. There is a scientist love using the word homeostasis to describe it. If you have experience in drinking alcohol, the first peg of alcohol gives you like in a crazy high. It makes you feel very weird and immediately you feel the effects of alcohol. But as you become a seasoned alcohol consumer, what happens? you realize that you need more and more amount of alcohol, more and more servings of alcohol, a larger amount of alcohol, to get or experience the same amount of high. This is because the body's defense mechanisms have come in. They have made your body less sensitive to alcohol. In other words, your body resists alcohol. Similarly, and that leads to alcoholism, in fact, because if you can't live without that bliss that alcohol gives you, and because of the resistance the body builds up to alcohol, you start consuming more and more and more alcohol. Similarly, when there is a very high dosage of drugs given to the human body resists these drugs. So you require more and more drugs to feel the same effect. And just similarly, when the levels of insulin in your blood are extremely high, the body cells start resisting insulin. So that's just a defense mechanism of the body. It's a natural process. But what is interesting to ask is, how does this resistance manifest itself at the microscopic level? At the minutest level, what exactly is happening which can be called as insulin resistance? That general logic is fine, that when something is too high, the body develops resistance for it. But we are trying to understand type 2 diabetes in great detail. So we have to ask the question, how exactly does this resistance come? You may remember that the function of insulin is to act like a key on the lock of the cell. Technically, we have what are called insulin receptors on the cell. The insulin molecules go and react with those receptors that enables the absorption of glucose. But let's stick with the lock and key analogy for a moment. You've got body cells, they've got locks. Insulin is the key that opens the lock and allows glucose to come in. So one possibility is that somebody has changed the lock. That's why the key of insulin is not able to open the lock. But we can do detailed molecular studies of the receptor cells, the insulin cells, and this has been ruled out. Scientists have done very detailed analysis and they say no, the lock and the key remain the same, something else is happening. So here is the alternate and most likely the correct explanation. I'm sure it's the correct explanation, seems reasonable to me, of how insulin resistance develops. Your cells have a finite capacity to absorb glucose. So let's say you eat your food. It is rich in carbohydrates. So you produce a lot of glucose through digestion. Insulin comes, opens the locks. Your cells absorb the glucose. But your cells have a finite capacity for absorbing glucose. But your blood glucose remains high. So more insulin is produced. More insulin is opening the locks and saying, Mr. Glucose, please step inside the cell. Right? But either the cell or the glucose is talking back to insulin and saying, there is no space to go inside, my dear friend. There is no space to go inside. Imagine the situation to be like a superly filled train. There's a crowd standing on the platform. These are the glucose molecules in the blood. Insulin is like the conductor who is supposed to make all the people standing on the platform enter inside the train. When the train comes and the doors open, the conductor opens the doors. But the train is full. There is no space inside the train. Even though the conductor has opened the doors of the train, there is no place on the train for our passengers on the platform, the blood glucose, to get inside. So this is a well-accepted modern theory of how insulin resistance happens. The cells are so saturated with glucose that even if insulin insists that the blood glucose be absorbed by the cells don't have the capacity to absorb it. And that's how the resistance is born. So let's try to complete our story. We have very high glucose, so much so that the cells are saturated with it. So even when the insulin is telling the cells, cells say no, we cannot take any more glucose. That is your insulin resistance. As a result, the blood glucose is very high. Because the blood glucose is very high, even more insulin is produced by the pancreas. Even more saturation of glucose inside the cells happens, but the blood glucose still remains high. The kidneys are now stepping in and urination is increasing. In the meantime, liver has started a process called DNL, de novo lipogenesis. Now here is something interesting. Imagine that there is so much glucose because of this insulin resistance that the speed with which DNL produces fat is much higher than the speed with which the triglycerides can be transported and safely stored in your fat tissues. Where does the fat go? Right? Think of it like a factory. The machines inside the factory are manufacturing cars. But there is no space. The speed with which cars are being manufactured is much greater than the speed with which engineers can take the car and put it into the warehouse. What happens? All of a sudden, the cars are just sitting wherever they want. Every place you go, car is sitting on top of car. Car is sitting inside behind another machine. Just the cars are basically put wherever there is space. So imagine that de novo lipogenesis is happening so fast because of this huge amount of glucose, which by the way is because of insulin resistance, that there is not enough time to transport that fat being manufactured by DNL and put it safely in the fat tissues. So where does the fat go? The fats get deposited. The fats get deposited inside liver and other organs, which also explains why fatty liver is a very commonly found phenomena among type 2 diabetic patients. Now imagine that you have a cell. That cell already is struggling to absorb glucose and now it is surrounded by fat tissues. It becomes even harder for the cell to absorb glucose because it is surrounded and choked by fat cells or triglycerides. So the cells develop even more resistance because it is surrounded by fat. It is not able to even absorb sugar, right? So even if it was able to use its own internal sugar, right, and maybe it was not saturated, it is now surrounded by fats. And therefore, even if it needed, even if it had the capacity to absorb glucose, chances are that because of being choked in fat, it may not be able to absorb glucose. So that's how the saturation of the cells leads to fat production, which leads to even more resistance. And that's how insulin resistance is born. And to make things worse, there's a well-known phenomena known as the Randall effect, which very loosely speaking says that the biochemistry that the body has to do to burn fat and the processes that the body needs to implement to burn glucose, these two energy paths, as they are called, cannot work simultaneously. So long as there is glucose available to burn, effective fat burning will never be done by the body. So that fat which has been generated and deposited in your liver and other organs just stays, because you know, as long as there is glucose to burn, why burn the fat? And that is what explains that point that we made earlier, that even if a person was thin, right, even if a person was thin, that is within a reasonable BMI, if this process was happening inside the person's body and there was these fatty deposits all over the organs in the abdomen, they could still get type 2 diabetes, because type 2 diabetes is insulin resistance. And a major contributor to insulin resistance is the presence of visceral fat or ectopic fat, that is fat deposited in the organs near the abdomen. So I hope you're beginning to appreciate how we reach that stage where we become type 2 diabetic. But there's one extra step left to complete the full story. It has been found among many patients, a phenomena known as beta cell fatigue. So beta cell basically is that cell in pancreas which is responsible for producing insulin. So The production of insulin by the beta cells also slows down when a person has had type 2 diabetes for a very long time. This is called as beta cell fatigue. Essentially, the beta cells are tired of producing insulin, if you believe these words. And a lot of people believed that when you have had diabetes for a very, very long time, the beta cells basically have died. They have worked so hard to produce insulin that they have just become thin and died out. That is one explanation that has been on the table for a very long time. A lot of people find this theory that the beta cells have died by overwork questionable. The couple of objections are given to this theory. Firstly, whenever a body part is strained, it generally responds by strengthening itself. That is how bodybuilders build muscles. That is how the world's strongest people build strength. They push their body to limits to become stronger and stronger. So why doesn't a beta cell become stronger and more powerful if it is stressed out so much? That is like one question people ask when they want to doubt this theory of beta cells dying out irreversibly. The second is, it has been well established among many patients that this condition called type 2 diabetes in general can be reversed. Reversal means that if a person has to be no longer type 2 diabetic, it means that their beta cells should be able to start producing insulin with the same efficiency as they did when they were normal. The fact that patients are able to reverse their diabetes means that this theory, which says that beta cells die, cannot be true. Also, we have seen that type 2 diabetes is seen in children. If a person has had diabetes for 15, 20, 25 years, that hypothesis is at least reasonable that the beta cells have just become tired and died out. But how can you explain type 2 diabetes in children, right? So an alternate theory has emerged, which tries to explain why beta cell malfunction or fatigue happens. And that is, we have to go back to that point of fat deposits, right? If you remember, we had said that because of insulin resistance, there's such a rapid pace with which triglycerides are being manufactured that they are able to choke the organs. And one organ that they can choke is the pancreas itself. So the pancreas becomes a fatty pancreas, just like liver becomes fatty liver. So these ectopic fats, or the fats embedded inside the organs, can choke the beta cells. And as a result of that, the beta cells are no longer able to produce insulin with the same efficiency as before, because they are just surrounded and saturated by fats. This explanation, by the way, explains all our objections that we raised previously. How do you reverse diabetes? If you can somehow figure out how to destroy the fats that are choking the beta cells and, you know, free the beta cells, then they'll start functioning normally, right? And why is it seen in children? Because you don't need a lot of time, 10, 15, 20 years to damage beta cells. All you need to do is produce fats fast enough so that the beta cells are surrounded by fats and unable to do their job or release insulin into the blood efficiently. So these are the two phases in which type 2 diabetes happens. In the first phase, you have so much glucose that the cells are saturated with glucose and they start resisting insulin. And then that further leads to creation of immense amount of fat, which chokes the organs, further worsening the resistance. And then in the second phase, when the beta cells of the pancreas themselves undergo that choking phenomena, they are not able to produce insulin efficiently, leading to full-blown type 2 diabetes. Now, let's add another element to this story, which is an element called fructose. So, what is fructose and why is it important? Sugar comes in many forms. The primary forms are glucose and fructose. Glucose can be absorbed by any body part. So if there is glucose in your blood, your legs can absorb it, your brain can absorb it, any body part can absorb it. But fructose can only be absorbed by the liver. It is a very unique sugar. It cannot be absorbed by any body part except liver. Now, why is this important? It is important because when we consume fructose, our blood glucose levels doesn't increase, because obviously fructose not equal to glucose, so obviously it doesn't affect our glucose levels. It's a different kind of sugar. And because insulin doesn't really want the body organs to absorb something they cannot absorb, so the insulin doesn't care about fructose. But the liver, being the only organ that can handle fructose, has to handle fructose alone. So a certain author calls it a guided missile. Fructose is like a guided missile that straight away goes and hits your liver. So when you eat fructose, it is only liver that can handle it. And generally when that fructose is eaten with other foods, which are already providing you with plenty of glucose, what happens? Most likely, your glycogen stores, your absorption of glucose by the organs, everything is taken care of. The only pathway remaining to take care of any excess sugar is to do de novo lipogenesis, that is construction of fat. And now you get this sugar called as fructose, which your other body organs will not even help in absorbing. The liver alone has to absorb it. So it becomes even easier for fat manufacturing to take place and fatty liver to be formed when fructose is a part of your diet. So it is very important to understand where fructose comes from. The primary sugar in fruits is fructose. Your white sugar, which you put liberally in your cup of tea or your cup of coffee, is a molecule called sucrose, which is made of one glucose molecule and one fructose molecule. So 50% of white sugar is fructose. Fructose is also present in 55% proportion in something known as high fructose corn syrup, which in many countries remains the cheapest way to make something sweet. So all the sauces, spreads, cookies, breads, which are manufactured on very large scales and need some sweetening agent, tend to use high fructose corn syrup. So there are plenty of places from which you can get fructose, right? And they are all very easily available to us modern people. And because fructose can lead to instantaneous formation of fatty liver when you're eating, especially when you're eating with other foods, and the fact that fructose is abundantly available in many of the ready-made products that we see in the market, makes it a very important contributor to this whole story. In fact, there is a couple of studies that have been conducted where they try to compare people who eat fruits as a separate meal, say at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, versus those people who eat fruits as dessert immediately after their lunch or dinner. And it was found that people's triglyceride levels in the blood were high if they chose to eat fruits immediately after the meals. And I think we can explain this with all the things that we have learned so far. You have already eaten a meal, so your body has enough storage of glucose happening. All the organs in your body have absorbed glucose, the glycogen stores are full. So the liver is now going to take any extra form of sugar and produce fat, triglycerides out of it. Now, the body is already full, and now you decide to have fruits. Fruits contain fructose. What the hell does the liver do with that fructose? Instant de novo lipogenesis and manufacture of triglycerides. So all those studies which have pointed out that eating fruits immediately after meals boosts triglyceride levels, we have just managed to explain this by understanding the fact that fructose can only be absorbed by liver and liver alone. The fructose element also explains something very, very interesting. We've all been saying very high amounts of carbohydrates is leading to insulin resistance. But an important question that we can ask is, there are many cultures in the world which for centuries, not decades, for centuries have eaten in as a part of their diet as high as 90% carbohydrates. For example, the one well-known cited example is that Chinese folks, right? They eat a lot of white rice. That's carbohydrates. There are many other cultures in Asia as well, which go as high as 95% carbohydrates in their daily diet. But diabetes was never found. But recently, in the last 20-30 years, the prevalence of diabetes has gone up in those countries. Well, they have always been diabetic. Sorry, they have always eaten carbohydrates, but why have they become diabetic now? Because along with their regular diet, they are also absorbing a lot of modern diet, which is very high on fructose, white sugar, high fructose corn syrup, and so on. So, to over and above their complex carbohydrates, they are now adding fructose-based products to their diet, and that is what is explaining. So, you have to appreciate the fact that it is not that carbohydrates are bad. There are certain kinds of carbohydrates that are bad. And fructose is an important bad carbohydrate that one has to be aware of. Okay. So I hope with all the information that has been dispensed so far, you can appreciate that it is high non-complex or rather high simple carbohydrates, white sugar, and more importantly, fructose, which are creating the conditions in the body that lead people to become type 2 diabetics. We will now learn a bit more about the biochemistry of type 2 diabetes and related matters to try and explain a very important point I made earlier. I had mentioned that type 2 diabetic patients also suffer of incredible number of health problems. We had cited retinopathy, nephropathy, neuropathy, atherosclerosis, etc., etc. We had said that all these diseases are natural among type 2 diabetics. So we have explained how type 2 diabetes arises because of insulin resistance, but let us now try to understand how we can explain type 2 diabetes and its link with all these many diseases that we just listed out. Now, a very important test that is conducted for patients these days, not just type 2 diabetics, but any patient who is suspected of having some health problems, is something known as the lipid profile test. Those of you who may not know, and even those of you who may know, treat it like a revision. There are three important quantities that can be seen as a part of the lipid profile test results. One is triglycerides. Second is LDL, that is low density lipoprotein, also known as bad cholesterol. Then HDL, high density lipoprotein. Now imagine that you have gone to a pathology lab, you've given your blood work, the lipid profile test report has come back, and you're showing it to a doctor. So this is typically how your doctor will read the report, right? He says, triglycerides, they are high. Okay, I will give you medication, don't worry. Then he looks at low density lipoprotein and he says, LDL, high. Okay, I'll give you some medication. But HDL, low. And the doctor will get scared and you will also get scared. Because a low value of HDL, also known as good cholesterol, a lower than normal value of good cholesterol or HDL is a very serious indicator of heart problems and all kinds of other health problems. Right? So even if your triglycerides are high, the doctor will, in a very calm voice, tell you, please take medication, be happy, be chilled. If your low density lipoproteins are also high, higher than normal, your doctor will very calmly give you a prescription. But the moment you see a low value of HDL, there is a good chance that your doctor will give you very serious warnings and will give you scary. A low value of good cholesterol is considered very, very dangerous by many doctors. It's highly correlated with heart problems and strokes and all kinds of other problems. So what if I told you that this trifecta of bad values, that is high triglycerides, high low density lipoprotein and low HDL are all connected with type 2 diabetes. So this is how they are connected. We all know by now that when there is excess glucose, there is a process called as de novo lipogenesis that is taking place, which is going to obviously increase the level of triglycerides. Now, triglycerides are not supposed to just sit there. They are supposed to be transported to fat cells for storage. Now, there is a complex biochemistry that happens that allows the liver to construct triglycerides, put them in the blood, and then from the blood, they are transported to the fat cells and absorbed by the fat cells from the blood into them. Right? So, what happens is the triglyceride molecules are locked by a molecule called VLDL, very low density lipoprotein. So, the triglyceride molecule is, loosely speaking, packed or locked by VLDL, put into the blood. And then it transports to the fat tissue. Then under the guidance of insulin itself, by the way, what happens is that there are two chemicals that are produced. I'll not bore you with details. They are called LPL and CETP, but we'll not worry about what exactly they do. They just help in the absorption of triglycerides from the blood to the fat tissue. Now, LPL does the following. It unpacks triglycerides from VLDL. When that happens, VLDL becomes LDL. Do you recognize LDL? That's the bad cholesterol. So triglycerides are produced because of this high insulin levels. So we can explain high amount of triglycerides with type 2 diabetes. What we are now saying is in the transportation of triglycerides to fat tissues, a molecule called VLDL becomes LDL, the bad cholesterol, and gets released into the blood during the transportation. So, the transportation of triglycerides increases the amount of LDLs, which we call as bad cholesterol. So I'll summarize once again. High amounts of bad cholesterol happens because of triglyceride transportation. Now remember that when you want to absorb the fat from the blood into the adipocyte or the fat tissue, there's a second chemical that is released called CETP. CETP does the exact opposite of LPL. LPL is creating LDL. CETP is destroying HDL. So, when you have type 2 diabetes, triglycerides sky high, bad cholesterol sky high. Why is bad cholesterol sky high? Because it is produced as a result of transportation of triglycerides. Good cholesterol becomes lower. Why does it become lower? Because another chemical that helps in the transportation of fat from blood to fat tissues destroys HDL. So this extremely bad lipid profile report is a natural consequence of insulin resistance, aka type 2 diabetes. Now at this point, we can ask a reasonable question. You just said the body is an amazing organ, amazing system. It uses something called homeostasis in order to protect from dangers of extreme. It is because of homeostasis that I have to spend more money on alcohol to enjoy better. Where is that homeostasis? Why isn't homeostasis protecting my body from the effects of having too high levels of triglyceride? Now, this is where I introduce a very important concept. The body does protect you, my dear friends. The body does protect you from the effects of having too much fat created in your digestive system. How? When you eat, if you eat such a large quantity that now the liver is using de novo lipogenesis to start manufacturing triglycerides, the body automatically produces a hormone called leptin. What does leptin do? Leptin is very magical. It creates situation in your body, in your digestive system, where you start feeling full. You may remember someday you were eating your favorite dish and you kept eating, and after some time your body was full. You started breathing heavy, you started feeling full, and even though you're eating your favorite dish, you tell the person serving the dish, if you give me one more spoon, I will vomit. I am feeling full. Oh my God, I am feeling very bad. That nausea which prevents you from overeating is because of leptin production. And leptin is produced whenever a high amount of fat, aka triglycerides, are produced. Leptin prevents you from overeating. But unfortunately, in the case of type 2 diabetics or even type 2 pre-diabetics, there is a very high level of insulin, and very high level of insulin has the capability of suppressing those signals of leptin. And this is known as leptin resistance. It is because of leptin resistance that you don't feel that natural sensation that the body gives you, which makes you stop overeating. So type 2 diabetes even destroys that defense mechanism of the body known as the leptin effect and causes leptin resistance. Your body is able to resist leptin, which creates another major problem. Because there is leptin resistance, your body no longer gets a signal to stop eating, and you can easily overeat. You can keep on eating and eating and eating without feeling any nausea because leptin resistance. And if you understand that type 2 diabetes also causes all these wrong values in your lipid profile tests, you can explain every other major issue, the whole body problem of type 2 diabetes. How? If you have low values of good cholesterol and high values of triglycerides and bad cholesterols, you will start getting fat deposits, plaque deposits in your blood. If those deposits happen in the arteries carrying blood to your eyes, then you get retinopathy. If they produce a condition, they can produce conditions which affect the blood supply to your legs and other tissues, then all those other issues that we talked about are, you know, explained by the fact that blood supply itself is screwed up. Blood supply itself is screwed up when the lipid profile of the blood is screwed up. And once the blood, which reaches all organs of the body, that blood supply itself is screwed up, then it's obvious the whole body will get screwed up. So this is a very partial and loose explanation of how type 2 diabetes has a tendency to wreak havoc on every part of your body. And worse, it can make you volunteer to make your condition worse because you don't know when to stop eating. You feel like you can eat as much as you want because, you know, the leptin reactions are not happening. So this is the story of the biochemistry that leads to type 2 diabetes and the incredibly large number of effects that happen as a consequence of type 2 diabetes. We shall now talk about treatments. Okay, and this is the most important section. So even if there are many, many things that you could not fully digest, absorb, or understand till this point, everything that I say from this point is highly relevant. You really, really should take away important key lessons from these sections of the podcast, because we are now finally talking about treatments. The reason we have gone into such detail in understanding the biochemistry of type 2 diabetes is I want the treatments to make obvious common sense to everyone. And that can't be done until you understand what's happening inside your body. So let's start with that. So let's start with what conventional treatment is. As I mentioned, a conventional doctor traditionally has always tried to give you medications to regulate the glucotoxicity, that is the toxic levels of blood glucose or sugar levels in your blood. We must normalize your sugar levels. That is the target, right? So what are the medicines that they give you? One major class of medicines they give you are what are called sulfonylureas. How do they work? They basically boost the production of insulin in your body. Okay, and a lot of people who take these sulfonylureas, glimepiride is a sulfonylurea, they generally report that they are gaining weight because of these drugs, which is easy to explain, right? These drugs are boosting insulin production so that sugar level can be brought down. But when you have even more insulin, what happens? De novo lipogenesis, construction of fat. So obviously you will gain weight. And a lot of researchers now agree that treating diabetes with sulfonylureas or tablets like glimepiride is a dangerous and a very bad treatment for type 2 diabetes. The most popular drug by far has to be metformin, which is sold under a variety of brand names depending on which part of the world you are from. So metformin works by interfering in the very process of glucose production by the liver. So it doesn't exactly affect the weight of patient. It doesn't interfere with the insulin production in the patient. So it's actually a better treatment compared to sulfonylureas, glimepiride, etc. But still, is it really great? We'll answer that question. And recently there is a whole class of drugs that are doing something innovative, right? There are some drugs that are encouraging the kidney to keep throwing away sugar via urine, right? But a problem with that is that if you are discharging sugar through urine, remember that sugar is loved by disease-causing bacteria and fungus, etc. So if you actually want to get infections, then it's easy to get them if you have kidneys throwing out sugar through urine. So this approach of boosting the ability of the kidneys to throw sugar outside the body, I don't know if that is a great strategy or not. There are some drugs which actually interfere in the carb digestion itself. So they argue, when the carbs are completely digested, insulin is, glucose is getting produced in high amounts, insulin, etc., etc., etc. So why don't we create a drug that directly interferes with the ability of the digestive system to digest carbohydrates so that, you know, all this problem does not arise. But a lot of people are complaining that when they take such drugs, they experience nausea because the digestion itself is not happening normally. So you can experience nausea. Another approach is, you know, to make your body feel like it's very full very early so that you eat less. And as I mentioned, if all these drugs are not able to maintain your level of sugar, then they start injecting you with insulin shots. But that's the worst possible treatment you could give to type 2 diabetes, isn't it? Because the fact that you have type 2 diabetes means that you have insulin resistance. And why do you have insulin resistance? Because your insulin levels are incredibly high. And now you are pumping even more insulin externally. So more insulin is definitely not a great treatment to give to type 2 diabetics. Now, at the beginning, when I told you all those crazy side effects of type 2 diabetes, how your eyes, your kidneys, your nerves, your legs, your heart, your brain, everything is affected, I had told you that even if a person manages to maintain their sugar levels normal for years and years and years through systematic usage of medications, through maintaining diet, they still suffer from these diseases and disorders. Why? Now we know why. Because none of these medications are addressing the real problem that is happening inside type 2 diabetics. It is not addressing insulin resistance. If it is not addressing insulin resistance, then the lipid profile, the fat generation, and all the other side effects of type 2 diabetes are not getting addressed. So, for me personally, it is not a surprise that even if people are disciplined with their taking of medications, their eating of food, they still suffer from all these problems because the medications are only helping with glucotoxicity and not with insulin resistance. And if you are tempted to ask me the question, should I throw away medications? The answer is no. Medications are important because there is something called glucotoxicity. High levels of glucose in your blood is bad. It is not good. So if medications are reducing the levels of glucose in your blood, that is a needed part of the treatment. The problem I'm trying to say is that type 2 diabetes is not just high levels of sugar. It is first and foremost a problem of insulin resistance. The problem with all these medications and treatments is they are addressing glucotoxicity, but they are not addressing insulin resistance. So we just talked about what kind of medications will be given to you if you go to a conventional doctor for your treatment of diabetes. But the doctor will not just give you medications, they will also ask you to lose weight, which is also a good advice. It is in line with what we have said. Because losing weight means burning fat means your liver, your pancreas become free of fat. So it is important, there's no doubt about it. So, but how do you go about losing weight? That could be a problem. The advice that is given to you on how you should lose weight, the advice to lose weight is not the problem. The advice on how to lose weight can be a problem. They will tell you, please reduce your calories. Sure. Please increase exercise. Sure. Does it work? No. Clearly, it doesn't. Compared to 1980, we have 4 times more patients of type 2 diabetes as measured 5 years ago. In 2016. Yes, if we had about approximately 100 million type 2 diabetes verified patients in 1980, we now have 450 million plus patients in 2016. The number would have gone worse in the last 5 years. I don't have the latest numbers. So if it is simple, just reduce the calories, increase the exercise, and you will lose weight, why are people continuing to become fat? Why are people not able to lose weight? Why are people increasing in their tendency towards type 2 diabetes? Right? Let's understand this. And there are plenty of studies, statistical studies that also prove that this advice doesn't work. So let's understand why it doesn't work. You reduce calories. What will happen? You will eat very less. You will be asked to eat very, very less, 6 times a day, 7 times a day. Will you feel happy? Will you feel satisfied? No. It will make you feel hungry. It will make you feel unsatisfied. One fine day, you're walking on the street. You see a good bakery with a big poster on it. Buy 1+1 free, like donuts. Immediately, you're so hungry and miserable because of eating low calories. It doesn't take any time to just break your diet and eat a donut while passing through a bakery. Or your favorite pancake or your favorite pastry or anything that fancies you. The second problem is that calories is just a bloody unit of energy. Our human body is not an arithmetic machine that merely does plus minus on calories. It is a complex machine. I dare you to write a medical examination based on the little knowledge that I have tried to give you about the biochemistry of type 2 diabetes. It's so complicated. I mean, hats off to all those medical students who learn about this for years and years and clear those examinations, right? And we are here just saying calories, less, more. No, food is more than calories. What are your calories made up of is also important. Most of us are following what is known as the food pyramid dietary pattern. And so 60%, the base of the pyramid, which is the largest, 60% of your diet should be carbohydrates, 30% should be proteins, 10% should be fats. Sure. But what carbohydrates? What kind of carbohydrates? And what is the problem with that fats that you can eat only 10% fats? You know, you'd be surprised to know that this recommendation of 60-30-10 was given by the American Health and Dietetics Association in 1977. Why? Because back then they believed that when you eat a dietary fat, it becomes body fat directly, and body fat causes heart attacks. So they said, don't eat fat, don't eat fat, don't eat fat. So if you don't want to eat fat and reduce it to 5-10%, you have to obviously eat a lot of carbohydrates. If you eat a lot of carbohydrates, you are bound to eat the wrong kinds. Especially if you eat the wrong kind of carbohydrates, we have just said the story 100 times. Insulin spikes, high glucose, fat production, etc., etc. Also well established by many studies is that when you eat a diet with very low number of calories, the body lowers what is known as the basal metabolic rate in order to compensate. Homeostasis at work once again. What is basal metabolic rate? Imagine there you're sitting on the sofa watching TV, your favorite activity in modern times, right? Binge watching, sitting on the sofa. Even when you're sitting on the sofa doing absolutely nothing, you are burning some energy. Why? Your heart is working, your lungs are working, your all other body parts are doing some work or the other. So the total amount of calories that are burned by your body without doing any work is called basal metabolic rate. When the body notices that you are eating incredibly low amount of calories, it lowers the basal metabolic rate. So it starts spending less energy or less calories. So the net effect is not that great. The whole purpose of eating less calories is that crazy equation which says eat less calories, burn more calories, you will lose weight. But if you are eating less calories, your basal metabolic rate is also going down, then the number of calories you are burning will also reduce, like a thermostat, right? It always maintains the same temperature. So the net effect, the total number of calories burned by your body remains the same, right? So that's not good. And moreover, the problem with a diet that is very low on calories, done conventionally, is very hard to implement, very easy to bounce back, right? By the way, some of you may get the wrong idea when I say that, you know, the 1977 recommendations where 10% fats only were allowed and that fats are bad is wrong, In 2015, in fact, the American Health Association took back its claim that fats are bad for you, right? But remember, just like carbohydrates come in, you know, all these refined forms as well as complex forms, even fats come in variety of forms. There are trans fats, monosaturated, unsaturated. Some fats are good for you. Trans fats, absolutely bad. Monosaturated, fair enough. But everything, just because something is good, it cannot be done in excess. So just a warning that yes, the American Health or Diet Association that gave out the 1977 recommendations was wrong in saying that all fats are bad, but doesn't mean that you go and just start eating oils and butters. Fats also come in different varieties, right? Okay, so let's continue with the conventional advice. So we said that lower your calories is overall not a great advice. You need to be a bit more intelligent there. The other is exercise, right? First of all, if a person has type 2 diabetes for a very long time, they are likely going to suffer from other diseases. Do you think it is easy for such a patient to do exercise? Second question you have to ask yourself is, how many calories do you think exercise can burn? Let's assume you eat 14,000 calories in a week and suppose that you take a walk for 30 minutes per day. A 30 minutes walk at most can burn 100 calories, which means if you walk every day for 30 minutes, you'll burn 700 calories. 14,000 calories consumed, 700 calories burnt by walking 30 minutes every day. Even if you walk 1 hour a day, maybe 1400 calories, but still 14,000 consumed, 1,400 burnt. So the number of calories that you burn as a result of vigorous exercise pales in comparison to how easy it is to consume these calories. I mean, it sounds very depressing. I keep telling people, when they offer me a sweet like a gulab jamun, which is like this nice red colored sweet that you get in India. So when they offer me, I say that is 30 minutes of walk. That small red ball is 30 minutes of walking. No, thank you. So the point being that the number of calories burnt in rigorous exercise pales in comparison to the ease with which all those calories can be consumed again. The third problem with, you know, advising do crazy exercises, exercise makes you very hungry and thereby makes it even hard for you to stick to your reduced calorie diet. The real problem that, as we've understood through our detailed analysis of type 2 diabetes, is that it is high carbohydrate input, more specifically bad high carbohydrate input. So the solution should be to lower the amount of bad carbohydrates that we eat. But unfortunately, the current solution that a lot of type 2 diabetics are adopting is just keep everything as it is, just try to dispose faster. So I came across this very nice example in a book by Jason Fung, right, which actually is an inspiration for a lot of the material I'm covering here today. He says, imagine there is a sink and it is overflowing, right? Doing more exercise is like increasing the size of the hole under the sink so that the sink will not overflow. A better solution is to turn off your bloody tap, which is causing the water to overflow to begin with. So we have to control what we put inside our bodies instead of mindlessly trying to burn more calories through exercise, right? So our solution, just to summarize, should be to watch out for all those bad carbohydrates and replace them with healthier alternatives. That is a solution. Not to exercise harder, not to eat continuously any arbitrary amount of low calories. No. So let's understand. Let me now finally present what is accepted as a very effective solution to type 2 diabetes by many experts. No, I'm kidding. Let me tell you something that gives us a clue as to what that solution is. So a long established fact is that people who undergo bariatric surgeries, right, can actually reverse, or rather end up reversing, type 2 diabetes. What is bariatric surgery? If you are extremely obese, like 40, 45, 50 BMI, then it is for your own benefit advised that we perform a surgery on you to remove your fat. A couple of things happen in bariatric surgeries. That's laparoscopy, by the way, but bariatric surgery is done for these very morbidly obese people. So they can remove part of your intestine, they can reduce the size of your stomach by putting a band on it, or maybe even cutting a part of it. And any person who undergoes bariatric surgery is known to become free of type 2 diabetes. So does that mean that the solution is type 2 diabetes is surgery? No, absolutely not. But the reason I'm telling you that this surgery causes reversal in type 2 diabetes is because I want you to understand why it causes reversal of type 2 diabetes. People who undergo this surgery, because of their reduced capacity to eat, cannot eat substantial amounts. So the overall food intake becomes very restricted. As a result, all the fatty deposits in the liver, the pancreas, and other organs, they disappear. And I told you that the beta cells, which were producing less insulin because they were surrounded by body fats, are now able to produce normal insulin. And all of a sudden, the levels of insulin fall and insulin resistance is gone. So the real question we should be asking is, we know that bariatric surgery patients can reverse type 2 diabetes, but we have to not conclude that surgery is important. We have to understand what the surgery does, which allows that reversal to take place. So I'm now finally going to present to you the two-step solution to reversing type 2 diabetes. Again, this is not perfect medical advice. Please talk to your doctor before making any drastic changes. First of all, get rid of that pyramid notion of diet. Your priority in reversing type 2 diabetes is to get rid of bad carbohydrates. What do you mean by bad carbohydrates? Well, when I said obesity, I was able to numerically define obesity as BMI. BMI greater than 25 is obese. So can I give you some number which you can use to differentiate between bad carbohydrates and good carbohydrates? Yes, I'll give you two numbers. Glycemic index and glycemic load. Let's understand this. Glycemic index is a measure of how easy it is, or how fast can a body convert that carbohydrate into glucose. The way it is measured is that sugar, which is glucose, is given a value of 100. Why? And because, so 100 is the highest value of GI, but why? Because you don't need to convert glucose into glucose. It's already glucose. So it's the fastest way of getting glucose in your body is to eat sugar. Any other carbohydrate has to be digested by your digestive system and converted into glucose. For some carbohydrates, it is very easy. So they will have high glycemic index. So the higher the value of glycemic index, say greater than 60, 70, 80, 90, easier it is for the body to convert it into glucose. The second quantity is glycemic load. Glycemic load refers to how much of that carbohydrate you should eat to get a certain amount of glucose, right? So if your glycemic index is high, then most likely it is a very bad carbohydrate, especially if it accompanies with an appropriate GL. So one day, like, I was walking across an aisle in a supermarket and I came across an exciting product. It said diabetic biscuits. And by then, fortunately or unfortunately, I had done all my reading about bad and good carbohydrates. And I realized, I just took the biscuits, I opened the pack, and I started reading the contents. The only reason it was considered as a diabetic biscuit is because it did not have any sugar in it. When you take any biscuit packet, any ordinary biscuit packet, and read the contents, it will say every 100 grams of this biscuit contains 28 gram sugar, 48 gram sugar, 78 gram sugar. But this diabetic biscuit said 0 gram sugar. Oh, that's why it is diabetic. I said, no. Look at the other ingredients it is made up of. Biscuits by definition are made up of highly refined carbohydrates, which are present in the form of the flour that is used to make the biscuit. Eventually, when I eat it, it is going to get digested. That carbohydrate is going to get digested and become sugar. Yes, by not adding separate sugar, you're making it a little better than the other biscuit. But the primary ingredient of your biscuit, is a refined carbohydrate, which will become glucose in my body and spike my insulin levels. So diabetic biscuits, please be careful. Don't be overconfident and start eating them in large quantities. And I had to tell a lot of my relatives who keep pushing me, you know, like when they learned that I had type 2 diabetes, they started, you know, gifting me digestive diabetic biscuits, etc., etc. And I had to more or less give this entire lecture to them in an abridged version, of course. Otherwise, they would leave me forever. I had to tell them, look, by definition, this cannot be diabetic friendly. And I tried to tell them why. But I hope you understand why. Because yes, direct consumption of sugar is bad. But even if you're consuming something which is a highly refined carbohydrate, it will have a high glycemic index, which means that very rapidly, it will spike your insulin levels and boost your glucose levels. Right? So what else is included in bad carbohydrates? All those regular suspects, your baked products. Every baked product is a high glycemic index, bad carbohydrate product. And here is an experiment that you can do. Next time you go to a supermarket, go through the section of all the ready-made, ready-to-eat foods, your chips, your biscuits, your nachos, everything. Take the packet, see on the backside, they have started giving you ingredients, right? They tell you how much carbohydrates, trans fats, proteins, sugars, etc. are present. Right? Just go through that. Go through those contents. You will find that most of them contain, of every 100 grams of the product, more than 60, 70 grams is carbohydrate. And I don't need to tell you what kind of a carbohydrate it is. It's a worst form of carbohydrate that you can have. In fact, when I was first given the news that I have type 2 diabetes, this is an exact exercise that I conducted. All those things that I liberally used to buy in the supermarket, I started reading behind. Carbs, 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 carbs. When I saw the shocking amount of carb percentage in those products, I just stopped buying them. Not good. So, the right diet. We are talking about the solution to reversal of type 2 diabetes. The first rule, get rid of those bad carbohydrates. How to recognize bad carbohydrates? First rule, look at the packet. If it contains an enormous amount of carbs, avoid it. Second rule, unfortunately, our government has not made it compulsory to publish the values of GI on these packets. But you can always use your cell phone or come back home, use your laptop. You can easily find the glycemic index values of all those foods. If you see an alarmingly high value of GI, think twice before eating. Also look at the glycemic load value. They should be used in comparison. So just filter out bad carbs from your life. And what do you eat after removing bad carbs from your diet? The traditional carbohydrates, which come with a lot of fiber. Brown rice instead of white rice, rotis or breads made of emmer wheat, more lentil based products, etc. So you want more traditional carbs and proteins to increase the lion's or take the lion's share of your diet. The traditional carbohydrates come with a lot of fiber. Because of the fiber, your digestion is much easier. It's a bit slower, so it doesn't spike the insulin level so high. And you need less quantities of it to feel happy, right? That is, so salads is a good source of fibrous complex carbohydrates, and also many, many beautiful chemicals that are useful for your body. And very importantly, avoid fructose. Fruits are good, there's no doubt about it, but fruit should not be eaten after a heavy meal. Eat them as a separate meal at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, in between your meals. That's fine. But never, never have fruits over and above your meal. As I already mentioned, get rid of all those fast food products which contain large amounts of sweeteners, pasta, sauces, spreads, etc. In fact, I remember this very funny incident that happened. A close relative of mine had taken up drinking soya milk because everybody had told him that soya milk is great for health, better than your regular milk. So they were drinking soya milk. But I said, isn't soya milk bitter? And that person says, yes, no, I enjoy it. I said, can you give me that packet of soya milk that you're drinking? And I take it and I turn back. Every 100 grams of soya milk in the packaged soya milk that you get in the market has about 48 grams of added sugar. So you really need to start paying attention to how much sugar per 100 grams is present in all these foods that you very casually eat. And while I don't fully understand why, I've also learned that a lot of artificial sweeteners are not good substitutes. A lot of people take these sugar-free, which are nothing but aspartame substitutes. Aspartame is a chemical that is sweet without giving you any calories like normal sugar does. So a lot of people very proudly start putting these artificial sweeteners in their drinks. But not all artificial sweeteners are good. So please be careful. Just sacrifice sweetness at least while you're aggressively trying to reverse these conditions. Okay, so we've covered diet. The second important advice that you have to try and follow to reverse type 2 diabetes is the practice of intermittent fasting. That is fasting for very long hours. There are various ways you can implement or incorporate intermittent fasting in your daily lives. One commonly used approach is the 16-8 approach, as people like to call it. People love making fancy names. So 16-8 approach is, you have your lunch at say 1 o'clock. You try to have your dinner by 7 or max 8 o'clock. So you have like 8 hours in which you have two meals. Then from dinner to the next day lunch, you have 16 hours where you don't have any food. So you fast for 16 hours and eat only within 8 hours. That's your 16-8 fasting rule. Another approach that works is you have 2 to 3 good meals per day, very nutritious meals per day. And then once in a week, for a complete day and a half to 2 days, you can fast. So why exactly does intermittent fasting work? Because it's insulin resistance in reverse. The process that led to insulin resistance, fasting is that process in reverse. Think about it. When you don't eat, what happens? All the glucose that is present in your organ cells is used up. Then whatever sugar is there in your blood, used up. When the blood sugar falls, what happens to insulin? Drops. So the level of insulin production falls. But body knows that if the blood glucose falls to very ridiculously low levels, the body is in danger and the body protects you. So it tells the liver and other organs of your body, please start removing your glycogen. We are in short supply of glucose. So the liver starts converting glycogen into glucose. Now, if you continue to fast, then all the glycogen is also exhausted. And again, the blood levels are severely low. So what happens? we start gluconeogenesis. Take, hey, you triglycerides, come here. I'm going to break you down into glucose. I'm going to break you down into glucose. I'm going to start processing into fatty acids, and I'm going to give you this one. In fact, there is something else that happens when you fast for very, very long hours, right? Since the fats cannot be used by your brain, the fatty acids, so when triglycerides break to fatty acids and fatty acids cannot be used by your brain, the body actually creates what are called ketone bodies to help your brain get some energy. And once that ketone production happens in your body, your brain becomes super sharp because it gets a stroke, it gets a burst of energy. And I've experienced this myself. I remember the first time I was fasting for a very long time. I was on the 24th hour of my fast. So I had not eaten for 24 hours. And suddenly, it felt like my brain had started accelerating. I was reading better. When I was reading, I was absorbing what I read much faster. When I took up programming is something I have to do as a part of my work, and it's also my hobby. My programming was happening faster. My typing speed had increased. It was like my brain had received a jolt of energy. And that was literally true, because I had fasted for so long that ketones bodies were being generated, and a fresh supply of ketone energy was being given to my brain. So it's approximately 12 hours of fasting that you need to do, after which this fat burning process can actually begin. And the fact that this happens in your body and there are such benefits also explains why this whole concept of eating a breakfast like a king, and that breakfast is the most important meal of the day, is stupidity of the highest order. I was a big believer in breakfast. Every time I saw that somebody is skipping breakfast because they are late for the office, I used to criticize them. Hey, why are you skipping breakfast? Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. But as I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes and I read all this, I realized that there is no such rule. There is no scientific principle that says that breakfast is the most important meal of the day. It's been more than a year now. I have not had breakfast, except for rare occasions where I'm traveling. I have not had breakfast. I don't miss breakfast. And I feel happy that I don't eat breakfast. It's one less meal in the day to worry about, right? Now, a lot of people, when I told them that intermittent fasting, even professional dietitians, when they hear that people should do intermittent fasting, argue that intermittent fasting reduces your basal metabolic rate. But there are plenty of studies that have now been done that show that BMR is not affected by intermittent fasting. And one explanation for why it does not reduce BMR is very interesting, right? Our human bodies have evolved through millions of years of evolution to survive very extreme conditions. So the ancient man, was in the habit of hunting for their food, or getting a supply of food from, say, berries, shrubs taken from the forest. And after they had eaten, right, they had to go and search for food once again. The next piece of meal that they would eat would be maybe 12 hours later, 16 hours later, 18 hours later. If our body was designed to slow down and become lethargic in just 10 to 12 hours, we would not be alive as human race today. Because our ancestors had the ability to survive 12 to 16 hours, not only without food, but have the energy to go and hunt another animal for a new meal that we are alive today. So our body has incredible capacity to withstand long fasting hours, and it does not reduce BMR. So a very simple study that was conducted took about a few thousand patients who ate 14,000 calories, but ate them as continuous small meals 5 to 6 times a day. And there were those patients who ate 14,000 calories, but they did intermittent fasting, which means their meals were heavier, but they had less number of meals and they had long fasting hours. At the end of a couple of months, they measured the basal metabolic rates of these two patients. They found that there was no change in the basal metabolic rate of the people who did intermittent fasting, while the people who did 6 to 8 times a day eating, they had very low basal metabolic rates. And as soon as they started eating normal, all the weight they had lost just came back. So intermittent fasting is a brilliant, brilliant thing to do, independent of whether you are type 2 diabetic or not. It is one of the best things you can do. It is also very practical in many ways, but be very careful, especially if you are type 2 diabetic. You must be very careful when doing fasting. As I mentioned, hyperglycemia, extra sugar in your blood, is better than hypoglycemia, which is very low sugar in your blood. The medicines that you might be taking as type 2 diabetics will reduce your sugar. And on top of that, if you fast and at the same time take those medications, your blood sugar can drop to a ridiculously low level. And that can be very, very fatal even, not just dangerous. It could prove to be fatal. So your levels must be monitored. If your doctor supports you in trying intermittent fasting, your doctors will adjust your medications. They will ask you to buy a glucometer, continuously monitor your glucose levels. Your body may become acidic because of excessive fasting. So you will have to have something ready in your home to counter that acidity. So please don't do intermittent fasting without supervision if you are a type 2 diabetic hoping to reverse diabetes. Now, the very last thing I want to put forth in this podcast is my personal experience, which I hope will encourage you. So it was a couple of years ago, as I mentioned earlier, I was falling ill very frequently. And because of falling ill very frequently, I decided I should go to my regular physician after my traveling was done and get myself tested. My doctor immediately suspected that I would be having high levels of sugar and type 2 diabetes. My physician asked me to get some tests done, and lo and behold, all my values were off the roof and I was officially declared type 2 diabetic. Now, because of my training as an academician, and because of my immense capacity to read books after books after books, I immediately bought some books which describe type 2 diabetes in them. And I started reading those books. And that is when I came across this entire study of the role of bad carbohydrates, the importance of intermittent fasting, and how to train yourself to do intermittent fasting, and how you can become completely medicine free and reverse your type 2 diabetes completely. And I went to my physician. I said, thank you for the medications. Thank you for your treatment. My blood sugars are very normal now. I am proud that all my sugars are very well controlled, but I want to defeat this disease. And I have been doing a lot of reading, and I have come across this practice of intermittent fasting, which allows you to reverse type 2 diabetes, and I would like to try it. Unfortunately, my physician told me, just do what I ask you to do. Don't become a doctor yourself. And till that day, I had no complaints about my physician. I respected their advice, their opinions, and I was very happy with all the guidance I had received. But when I wanted to debate, all this research that was sitting in my hands and the possibility of changing my treatment, I got zero support. That is when the academician in me awoke again. I opened my laptop, I opened a browser, and I started searching for India diabetes reversal intermittent fasting. And lo behold, I came across a group of doctors in the city of Pune who were promising to put patients in a program for type 2 diabetes reversal, and they had similar principles as what I had been reading about, which is to alter your diet, to remove bad carbs, to do intermittent fasting, etc., etc., etc. So I decided that I wanted to get enrolled, to get associated with this group. There's a reason why I'm not taking the name of this group, because I have not, you know, I don't want this talk to look like I am representing them. Neither do I want to risk the possibility that I have not cleared with them whether I should be taking their name or not, whether there's some issue in me being some kind of a representative. So I'm avoiding taking names here, but it's easy, right? I've already told you what to search for on Google to get hold of this group. Long story short, I came across this group. I enrolled for their program. I got associated with them. And I went through this crazy experience, right? The only thing I did was change my diet completely. Bad carbs, zero. Complex carbs, present in limited quantities. And a couple of other dietary adjustments. And this is what happened. All my medications stopped in 15 to 16 days. Yes, I am not joking. I kid you not. In 15 to 16 days, I was able to maintain my blood glucose levels without medication. And 3 months later, when I had my HbA1c test done, it was normal despite me not taking medications. Then slowly, after my diet, medication, everything was taken care of, I was trained on how to do intermittent fasting. I started by intermittent fasting for 16 hours. I reached 24 hours. I reached 36 hours. And then I slowly hit my personal record of 48 hours. Every week, I made it a practice that on Sunday night, I would have my dinner and I would directly have my dinner on Tuesday night. 48 hours of fasting. I, of course, allowed myself to drink a bit of black coffee, a little bit of lemon water in order to keep me from becoming too weak at times. But never did I have a single iota of food in these 48 hours. And I experienced amazing benefits. Right? I could see that my weight had started falling. It was lower than ever before in my life. My stamina levels, my energy levels were very high. There was a time when if I climbed two floors, that's two stories, I would start panting like crazy. Now I'm in a position where I climb 10 to 12 floors without panting. With very little elevation in my heart rate and my breath. The place where I stay, they have a ground downstairs where I could not run more than one quarter of the complete round around the building. Now I could do two laps without any interruption. The level of improvement that I saw because of the change in the diet, because of intermittent fasting, was amazing. And there was a certain mental benefit to the fasting as well. As I said, the ketone part. So the first 24 hours would be tough. But the next day when I woke up, which would make it the 36th hour of fasting, I had a certain sharpness to my brain. And I'm very convinced that all those people in the ancient days who claimed that their severe fasting in the name of spirituality or in the name of religion allowed them to connect to divinity, I kind of resonate with that, because when you do fasting for a long time, there is this process that happens which because of ketone bodies gives you this sudden high to your brain, a certain clarity and a peace of thought, a better awareness of this one. It is definitely not a hallucinogenic state. It is a well-established medical phenomena. As I said, the ketones give your brain a boost of energy and processing power, if you want to call it that. And there's a certain sharpness with which you start looking at things. And I think that the ancient folks who believed that fasting was connected with some spiritual experiences were probably had probably stumbled across this phenomena. And my real test came when we had a party after a very long time. The lockdown had started easing out, and we had a get together of nearby near ones. And I broke all my rules of diet that day. I had far more food than I had ever thought I could have. I ate cakes and pastries because it was a birthday party. We had sweets. We had unimaginable, ridiculous foods. And the next day morning, I very hesitantly took my glucometer and pierced my finger, put the sample of blood on the strip, and sugar levels were normal. So all those occasional indulgences did not affect my sugar level, which is why I can confidently say that indeed I have defeated type 2 diabetes. I always have to make sure that I don't get into bad habits which can bring it back, but officially I am free of type 2 diabetes. And I have a medical opinion to back this up. I asked my doctor, for the last 9 months, my HbA1cs are normal. I'm not taking medication. As per definition, am I type 2 diabetic or not? And he said, you are not type 2 diabetic, because there's no way that you can eat your occasional cake, you can eat your occasional sweets, you can break your dietary rules once in a while, and without any medications, if you are able to maintain sugar levels, it just means you don't have type 2 diabetes. So I know for sure that changing the diet correctly under medical supervision and doing intermittent fasting as a habit can help you defeat type 2 diabetes. I have met incredible people who have had 10 years, 15 years, 25 years of diabetes, who followed these simple principles and are now medicine-free, injection-free, incredible personalities. And I assure you that this works. So if you are any of those categories of people I was referring to at the beginning of my podcast, please pay attention to everything that I have said here in this podcast and use this information to guide and support and encourage all those who are suffering from this debilitating disease of type 2 diabetes. Spread the word. Type 2 diabetes is reversible. It can be defeated. And for those of you who don't have it, you can easily prevent it. All you need is knowledge. And that's why I, knowledgeably yours, have tried to painfully record this podcast. I noticed that we are well into our 2 hours, 20 minutes plus now. Behind the scenes, I have worked for last 2 weeks to prepare the outline for this podcast. And the reason is I genuinely feel that a lot of people are getting very bad advice on how to prevent type 2 diabetes, etc., etc., etc. I know that is not true, and I am a living example. I'm the first person in this generation of my family to have said bye-bye to it. I have not allowed this disease to take over me. So I hope you found the content in this podcast useful. As I mentioned again at the beginning, this is not pure medical advice. I'm not a medical professional. Even if I was a medical professional, this should not be used as medical advice. In case you are someone who is a medical professional and there are some obvious major errors that I may have made because I'm not an expert, please try to reach out to me, and I will try to publish an errata if I can. I'm going to leave you with a bunch of references that you can look at in order to expand your knowledge. My favorite book has been The Diabetes Code by Dr. Jason Fung. In case by some miracle, Dr. Jason Fung, if you are listening to this podcast all the way to the end, sir, please accept my gratitude, because if I had not read your book, I would not have believed that this disease is defeatable, and I would not have gone and searched for the doctors who eventually helped me to reverse my diabetes. So big thanks to Dr. Jason Fung for his incredibly wonderful book, The Diabetes Code, that actually gave me the inspiration to study in great detail and also inspired a large amount of the content that I have published here. Even his YouTube talks are worth listening to. I encourage you to search for Dr. Jason Fung on YouTube. There are other books that are written by Dr. Bernstein and Dr. Neil Bernard, which also I have read, and I encourage you to read them. For those of you who are based in India, please search on YouTube for videos published by Dr. Pramod Tripathi, who is doing some really amazing work in India in reversing type 2 diabetes using the similar principles that I have highlighted here. Once again, if you have made it this far, I think you are incredible. You have the patience and the interest and the zeal and the enthusiasm it takes to learn things. And when you learn things, you have achieved something great. You're on your way to a better life. And I thank you for your patience if you have reached all the way here. Thank you so much. And I hope the contents are useful. And I hope you will make sure that it reaches more and more people and encourages more and more people to both prevent as well as cure this disease, which has been wrongly assumed to be incurable. Again, thank you. Stay safe, and I shall see you in another episode soon. Bye-bye.